All right, thank you, ladies and gentlemen. We're going to start the afternoon session of the open consultations. I'll hand it over to Lynn.
Welcome. Thank you for coming back so timely. I know there was an awful lot everybody had to catch up on in the first lunch break, but we do have an awful lot to get through. We left just before lunch. We were on the second agenda item, taking stock of IGF 2015 while setting expectations for IGF 2016. And at that point, we had one person left in the queue, and that's Salah, and she's going to speak in a moment. And we have another one as well, Jovan. Okay, maybe just put, I'm not going to recognize everybody now. If you put your flags up, and Chengatai will note. And we can give a little bit more time to this, but I think we should start really ensuring that we're moving forward, looking to IGF 2016. And then, of course, we still have two other fairly substantive agenda items this afternoon. So with that, we'll move to Salah. Mm-hmm. Salah, you have the floor.
Thank you, Chair. This is Salah, also known as Salnieta Tamanika Wemero. So I'd like to make a few comments, and the first one being on the importance of taking into account the global context as context shapes meaning. Notably, 2015 represented a critical juncture in which various frameworks were finalized, some of which were being reviewed for the past 10 years last year, such as the post-2015 SDGs, the Sendai Framework for Disaster Risk Reduction, the Addis Ababa Action Agenda, and the Paris Agreement. Given that the Addis Ababa Action Agenda cemented the political will within the global community to create enabling environment through frameworks, policies, and initiatives that would help meet sustainable development goals. And critical to this is aspects of internet governance. If we were to retrospectively examine the context back from when the IGF first started, I know we're looking at 2015 IGF, but I think it's critical in terms of initiating or beginning the conversation on the 2016 IGF is to also look at the decade and how the, in terms of global trends, have sort of have impacted what were prevalent issues back then and how some of these issues have taken a back burner, and emergence of many issues that affect today's global landscape of internet governance. Some of these were mentioned today by colleagues from Belgium, who mentioned that there were increasing acts of terrorism in Belgium, and our sincere condolences. But this literally impacts on things like cyber wars and cybersecurity and how this affects limitation on rights. And also there are things like climate change that literally impacts the increasing incidences of natural disasters, which in turn literally impacts global infrastructure. For instance, Fiji recently recovered, we're trying to recover, from tropical cyclone Winston. And even as we speak now, they're going through flooding back home. And so globally, there have been millions of displaced persons, homeless people, and so forth. Now, what does all this have to do with 2016 IGF? I think, and this is what I wanted to get to, bottom line is the 2016 IGF presents an unprecedented opportunity for the internet governance stakeholders to build on conversations around fulfilling sustainable development goals in creative, innovative ways that latch on and harness, pivot on, and catalyze on the rich relationships within the multi-stakeholder community that we have. And particularly noting that there have been work that's been done already in terms of the linkages between the Addis Ababa agenda and the SDGs, and how we don't have to reinvent the wheel as the MAG, but how we can build on that and pivot on that to encourage the conversation on access. Which brings me to my last point, which is slightly related to modalities. that we should also consider in 2016, the 2016 IGF, to use the dynamic coalition, the DCAD's accessibility guidelines that was developed in Brazil. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you, Sala. Jovan, you were next. And I don't think you were here this morning, Jovan, but we're asking people to introduce themselves sure. and say what organization or stakeholder community they're from.
Sure, yes. I have been absent for quite a few years from IGF, therefore I need to reintroduce myself. I'm Jovan Kurbel, director of Diplo Foundation and head of a Geneva Internet platform here in Geneva. It's great to see you, Lynn, as a chair, and congratulations on this point. I was alerted to reflect on one important development from the last IGF, which is related to reporting from the IGF, and to see what ideas we can take for the next IGF. In preparation for Brazil IGF 2015, we asked our alumni and community what were their major obstacles in actively participating in the IGF. And there were three key points. One is that they missed the sort of bird-eye view. When you are immersed into IGF, you get lost after the first day because there are so many parallel activities. Second is that there is some sort of a question of consciousness that if you go to one event, you will miss another parallel event. And third point is that our colleagues wanted to have the follow-up about specific issues of their direct interest. Let's say cybersecurity, small island states, data protection, you name it and you have it. Based on that insight, in partnership with Internet Society, we prepared the reporting from the IGF, focusing on three elements. Reporting immediately after the session, therefore 2 hours after the session. Reporting what we called a morning coffee report, done during the night, and we were lucky that our team was in Europe, therefore we have the time difference working for us. Therefore, the IGFers had the report from the previous day next morning after the what happened during the previous day. And third feature, which we also noticed, especially from government representatives, they needed overall report Monday after the conclusion, first Monday after the conclusion of the IGF, for very practical reasons. They are back in their capitals or their organizations, and they need to report what they did during the IGF. Now, that was the approach which was apparently, based on the feedback from the IG community, highly appreciated, both by IGFers, if I can use this term, but also broader IG community. It was done in a capacity development approach. We had 20 rapporteurs who were trained in João Pessoa how to do a reporting from the events, ISOC ambassadors, Diplos alumni, and other colleagues. Therefore, there was capacity development aspect. In addition, reporting was done by combining traditional reporting by rapporteurs and data mining from the text transcripts. Now, I would say that quietly, it was one important innovation that increased the global footprint of the IGF. Therefore, more people were in position to follow it in the high-quality way. And it also provided some sort of compass for the people who were at the IGF to see what's going on, because this bird-eye view, as you know, is very often missing when you're at the meeting itself. And the third point, it linked to the mapping exercise that Digital Watch has been doing in cooperation with the Internet Society, mapping of the IG issues. Therefore, nowadays, you can follow all discussion at the IGF on, let's say, data protection and privacy, but on the deeper level, not on the level of the overall transcript, but also on the deeper level within the transcript. I think that we should put joint efforts, IGF community, organizations which are involved, in order to build on this exercise, which is also walk the talk. We speak about innovation, we speak about internet, smart meetings, and this is the way how we can make IGF even smarter. There are quite a few innovations that we have been introducing over the last 10 years. This is just a quick reflection about what's happened in 2015 and what could be the basis for 2016. Thank you.
Thank you, Jovan. Olivier, you have the floor.
Thank you very much, Madam Chair. Olivier Crépin-Leblanc. I'm the chair of ISOC UK England, but I'm also the chair of the Dynamic Coalition on Core Internet Values. First and foremost, I'd like to congratulate you on your new appointment as chair of this committee. It's great to see some redress of the lack of gender balance on the head table, and it's great to see that things are moving in the right direction for this. I note that there is a pretty good gender balance in the room, so that's a good thing. Now onto my substantive comments on the IGF. I'm going to be pretty short. One thing which hasn't been mentioned is the work of the Dynamic Coalitions for the first time in Joao Pessoa, which, by the way, was a fantastic meeting in which we all enjoyed. So thanks to the Brazilian government on this. For the first time in Joao Pessoa, the Dynamic Coalitions had two main sessions, with all of the Dynamic Coalitions being able to present the amount of work that they've done for the past X number of years since they were created. One of the great things is that it also enabled the different Dynamic Coalition leads to be able to talk to each other. And I think that's one of the really important things in this community, for people to talk to each other, for a collaboration across the different stakeholder groups and collaboration across all of the people that take part in those meetings. I'd like to call upon the MAC to really look at the statement that the Dynamic Coalitions have filed for the stock-taking, and hoping that there will be additional, well, for next year or this year, should we say, there will be also main sessions for the Dynamic Coalitions. And just to let you know that there is also, at the moment, a coordination group that is being, I wouldn't say created, because the terms are being drafted at the moment, and that will be presented to the MAG pretty soon. And finally, just to ask anybody who is interested in the Dynamic Coalitions to actually take part in the work here, a bit like the, it's intersessional work, and it's ongoing, and it's really, really worth taking part in that. So thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Olivier. That's encouraging to hear that news, too. Chengatai has asked for the floor.
Oh, yes. Sorry, I forgot to say this right at the beginning. The staff at WIPO have asked me to say that, to kindly remind you that there should be no food brought in to this, food and drink brought in, and also that there is going to be a reception after this, an ISOC reception, and it's going to be where?
Just outside.
Okay, thank you.
thank you. And I think someone from the U.S. delegation had asked for the floor. Is that no?
No.
Okay. Then
no. No. Sorry.
Then we move on to Leanne. You have the floor, Leanne.
Many thanks to our new MAC chair. And my name is Li Yunhan. I'm doing IG research in the Institute of Internet Governance Research, IGR. It is an IG-related think tank attached to CENIC. And I'm glad to be here to join this active discussion, and I would like to make some contribution to our IGF. And today I would like to share some emotional comments and suggestions for you, for all of you. Firstly, the first keyword is congratulations to our renewed mandate of next 10 years IGF. And it means we can do more deep thinking and consideration for the future IG, a good governance for the future internet. The second one is appreciation. The appreciation, I would like to express sincere appreciation for the last IGF in Joao Pessoa, and thanks for the MAC MAG members for the, you know, the well-designed of formats and the innovation of IGF formats, because last year I saw many changes of the formats and contents of the issues and topics. And many thanks to host country because it is it was an excellent event and made much more profession design. The third one is expectation, because that's why we again acquired so many success and deliverables. That's it benefits from the multi-stakeholder collaborations. So here I would like to call for everybody to make more contribution to this successful governance IG models and devoted ourselves to this process. And next, I would like to share two suggestions for the next IGF. The first one is I noticed there is some changes in the renewed WSIS plus document, because there much more emphasis was paid. Much more attention was paid on the bridging digital divide, but how to make these things happen? That's what we should deep think. And as I know, during the different regions and areas, there are many capacity building programs and IG schools. But due to the different culture reasons, it is difficult to adopt the universal methods to do the same things. So I think this in this year's IGF, maybe we should set up a main session or a best forum to share more experience of the different successful experience of the capacity building programs. Although it is not universal, but we can inspire from more different things. That's the first suggestion. And I noticed in the morning session, Mr. Hartmut mentioned the youth development. That's the key words to the future development, because the youth is the prosperity of the future. So we should pay more attention on this process. The second suggestion is the workshops selection, because last year I attended remotely the MAG meeting and open consultation. During the evaluation of the workshops, there are so many duplication of workshops, and it's hard to decide which one is audited and which one should be chosen. So maybe we this year, is it possible to set up a mechanism when a workshop go into the first round evaluation of MAG, maybe the MAG members can categorize the duplication workshops proposals and give the proposals, go back to the proposer and ask them to do the combination by themselves. Maybe doing this, firstly, it can boost the collaborations between the different proposals. And the second benefit is to boost more active resources. That's the second suggestion. Thank you.
Thank you. And Jim, I'm sorry, I think we missed you before. You're immediately behind Virat, and I only just now, I think Chengatai as well, saw your flag when Virat. It's fine. So I'll come to you in a moment, and then I think it's time to move on to the second agenda item. I think the last intervention was a really natural segue to talk about the WSIS outcome document and begin applying some of those directional comments, if you will. And I intervene at this point simply to say that we will kick off that session with some comments, some remarks by Wyman Kwok in just a few minutes. Again, he's a representative from UDESA. But Jim, we'll go to you for the final intervention.
Sure. Virat has both a physical and a personal towering presence. My name is Jim Prendergast, speaking on behalf of myself and my own firm, the Galway Strategy Group. But to follow on to some of the comments that Virat and others had raised earlier, applaud all the hard work that went into the development of the workshop criteria last year. I think the emphasis on highly interactive sessions, the movement away from panels is something to be applauded. Nothing breaks my IGF spirit more than going from a highly interactive session to one where there's six PowerPoints and six speeches and no interaction. But what I would ask the incoming MAG to consider is, when you spend the time, energy, and effort to develop these criteria, stick to it. Put them in place. Grade against what you have put in place. Unfortunately, I did some analysis of the workshops that were approved last year, and nearly 30 of them listed 10 or more panelists slash speakers. And those are the ones that were approved. In fact, six of them had between 15 and 20 participants. So I think that sort of runs counter to what the laudable goals are for the criteria that were put in place. I would just ask that going forward, keep that in mind, keep it highly entertaining and interactive, get the audience involved. We've all heard from each other several times. A lot of the same people have spoken on panels. I think everybody's familiar with that situation. Let's just try and put it into practice a little more. Thank you.
Thank you, Jim. So we're now moving into item number 3 on the agenda, which is to focus on the outcomes of the December 2015 high-level meeting of the General Assembly. It is, of course, that process which culminated in December that actually did give us the renewal of the IGF mandate. So with that, I'd like to invite Wyman to make a few comments, and then we'll have an open discussion.
Thank you, Madam Chair. We heard quite a few from you this morning. The year 2015 was a significant milestone for ICT, for development and the internet. I believe most, if not all of you, have witnessed to this overall review of implementation of the outcomes of the WSIS through a 6-month intensive preparatory process. The UN received diverse inputs from government, the private sector, civil society, international organizations, the technical and academic communities, and all other relevant stakeholders, taking stock of the progress of the implementation of WSIS and, of course, including the IGF. At high-level meeting and negotiations, including both multilateral and bilateral negotiations at the UN, which eventually led to the adoption of the outcome document, delegates have expressed the need for close alignment between the WSIS process and the 2030 agenda for sustainable development. This highlighted ICT cross-cutting contributions to the SDG and poverty eradication. Not only does the GA highlight the remarkable progress of ICT achieved in the past decade, it also acknowledged just the challenges, the continuing digital divides between and within countries, between women and men, the importance of protecting human rights online, and the need of addressing cybersecurity. As we all know, the mandate of IGF has been extended for another 10 years. But also highlighted in the outcome document, we need to make progress on working modalities of the forum and the participation of relevant stakeholders from developing countries. What is important, perhaps not mentioned now, is that as of now, the next review of the implementation of WSIS outcome will be held in 2025. Which is also in line with the end of mandate of this IGF. It may be a little far, but I think it's not too early for us to take note that the WSIS outcome, including the IGF outcomes, will also be an input to the review of the 2030 agenda for sustainable development. With that, I just like to highlight two major events which will take place in the UN. First is a multi-stakeholder forum on science, technology, and innovation for the sustainable development goals, or in short known as the STI Forum. This will be held on the 6th to 7th of June at the UN headquarters, ECOSOC Chamber. This STI Forum is actually mandated by both the Addis Ababa Action Agenda and the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development. And the main task is actually how to develop and operationalize the technology facilitation mechanism online platform, among other tasks, which again are called for by the SDG. It would be worth considering to see how the IGF could contribute to this SDI forum, possibly including some of you as MAC members or the MAC chair to be there to participate some speaking roles, that we could explore that option. The second event is the high-level political forum, which will be held on the 11th to 20th of July in New York. HLPF, in short, this is the central platform at the UN for the follow-up and review of the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development adopted last year. In particular, the 2016 theme this year is to ensuring that no one is left behind. I think that this is also very important and timely theme, which the UN member states will put in a lot of efforts and consideration. And I must say that both of these, there's also a multi-stakeholder approach to both of these two events, including both online and offline, which is, I think, some of which is actually learning from the experience of the IGF. So that's all I have. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you. So we're now still in the open consultation. And again, our preference is to hear from non-MAG members, and that this is the day for your contributions. So I will open the floor up to any questions, comments, or topics that might come to mind as a result of that agenda item. Do we want to pursue perhaps with some discussion how some of the IGF work might in fact tie to the SDGs to try and get some topic here in the room? Although I see, I can't quite see only a hand in the back, so you have the floor.
Thank you, Madam. This is Shoya Yang from ITU. I'm here speaking on behalf of the Dynamic Coalition of Accessibility and the Disability. I am sorry that we were not able to catch the early part of the agenda, but I would like just to mention that the synthetic paper, the Dynamic Coalition on Accessibility and Disability, are not happy that we are regret we couldn't agree that paper closed on a positive note of the accessibility arrangement for IGF 2015. And I was asked by the DECAD as its secretary to make this point here that we really hope that the DECAD guideline on accessibility should be used and make use of in the preparation of IGFs and after this 10 years of IGFs. And this is the point. And there is a confliction of meeting which the chairman of DICAT couldn't attend it today. And she will attend it tomorrow and the day after tomorrow. I'm talking about Madam Andrea Sachs. Thank you.
Thank you for those comments. We do attach great importance to the guidelines for accessibility, and also with our host country agreement, we attach those guidelines to the agreement, and with our discussions with Mexico, for instance, last week, those were attached and we did touch upon them. As for 2015, we did try our best, but I would also like and encourage you to come and we can talk about it and have and discuss ways and issues on how we can improve.
We'll actually allow, with exception, I think, of a response since your hand has gone back up, and then we'll move back to the queue.
thank you. I appreciate the response from the Secretariat, and we do appreciate that there's always a case that the Secretary had tried their best to accommodate the request of accessibility. However, we just wish that we see this request being made by DECAT every year repetitively in the past 10 years, and we hope that we could do better for the future.
I think we're all in agreement on the hopes for doing better in the future. Thank you. So we have a queue. We have Virat, Peter, and Omar in the queue, and the woman back there.
Thank you, Madam Chair. On the issue of linking SDGs to our work this year and the future, I think if we were to just take a quick note of the guidance that we are receiving, both sort of directly in this room since morning and in the documents earlier. The business outcome document section 63 specifically goes to, and I quote, "We recognize that during the period the forum should continue to show progress on the working modalities and the participation of stakeholders from developing countries." The working group on IGF improvements is chaired by Peter, and I know that he's sort of going to speak soon after this. Section 37 to 41 are almost entirely focused upon LDCs and the participation of LDCs in IGF. So those are two specific guidances. This morning, the statement that has been read by DESA, the second statement that has been read about the two events and the invitation to participate, as well as the letter that was circulated by the former chair of the MAG last year towards, I think, September time period, where there was a very direct request from Mr. Hongbo to link the workings of the IGF to SDGs. So I think we have a host of material and sort of look at the guidance that we are receiving, both by the community and the UN, the governments who are involved in this. I think we should really commit ourselves as much as possible this year to try and do something which can be a part of the process, a longer 10-year process that my colleague Hossam spoke about on the developing countries. And I think it'll have many hues and shades, but the first thing is really to get them to start participating. It is a little concerning that the number of countries dropped last year from 144 at Istanbul to 112. So we need a wider participation, not fewer. And in that extent, if we can and I think we all know that SDGs are now percolating very deeply into national policy documents of developing countries. Governments are reporting on that. They're regularly in those meetings. I'm sure there'll be meetings in July. So to the extent we can, I would suggest we could look at a major intersessional theme this year, which culminates into a main session, which talks about the developing country participation, both in physical, remote, online, at the workshops, at all levels. I just wanted to commend the DESA by another number. I'm not sure how many have done this analysis, but 61% of the current MAG is actually developing countries. 45% are women. Of the new participants who've come in, 71% are actually from developing countries. Slightly fewer number of women, but the overall women in, and you know, so the gender balance is fantastically maintained. But also, very strong emphasis on developing country by DESA. So, lots of signals. We just have to now get our act together this year. And this, Madam Chairman, if you will, can become a three-year program. You know, we look at participation, then we look at specific SDGs, and then Madeline is here, and she could probably speak about the national and regional IGFs and how they are incorporating the work on SDGs, and if they could start bringing this work up starting this year, I think we could have a real, this year would be just the beginning, but perhaps the new MAG members have taken over, 22 of them. By the time they end their three-year tenure, you'd have some substantive documents come in and, you know, improvements in terms of both participation and qualitative inputs that can be done specifically from the point of view of developing countries linked to SDGs. Thank you.
Thank you, Virat. And you mentioned a number of sort of key documents in our work. we've all referenced, but I don't know that we've actually stated directly, of course, that another key document is the CSTD Working Group on Improvements to the IGF, and that's also another significant contributor to our work.
Actually, I did refer to the section 37 to 41 are dedicated to that. Yeah, that's fine.
Peter, you have the floor. Thank you.
Thank you, Lynn. I'm Peter Major from Hungary, but this time I'm going to speak on behalf of the CSTD. I'm the chair of the CSTD. And I really want to commend the work of UNDESA in coordinating the VISIS Plus 10 review and the really fantastic achievement which has been achieved during 6 months, which is needless to say that with the involvement of all stakeholders, it was a real great result. Having said that, the outcome paper gave a lot of tasks to the CSTD itself. As you may know, the CSTD is mandated to do the VISIS system-wide review, and we are tasked to continue this. We should identify and promote specific detailed actions to support the enabling environment for ICTs and development and provide the demand-driven policy advice, technical assistance, and capacity building as appropriate. Personally, I have been charged to establish the Working Group on Enhanced Cooperation, but the reason I took the floor now is the fourth task, which is to report on the implementation of the recommendations of the Working Group on the improvements to the IGF. So this is also something which I should be dealing with. And I really want to commend also the Secretariat of the IGF and personally Chengetai, who regularly reports to the CSTD and provides input. However, probably it needs a broader involvement from the community and in specifically the MAG. So I really encourage the MAG to take this issue very seriously, because probably this is something which will be all the time during the 10-year period on the table. We should really report them. Thank you.
Thank you, Peter. Omar, you have the floor.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Madam Chair, there are countries who never participated in any of the IGF. And I'd like to add to Virat's that we need better ways to engage local communities, especially the countries that are least developed or countries that never participated in the IGF process. One of the issues is that the website for a international global IGF launches a bit late, which is very close to the event, and there's no mechanism to reach out to different communities and engage them. And the main website, we have needs some improvements because as I can see, it's a little difficult to navigate. It's old, and if we can improve that a little bit more to make it easier for people to navigate, find information on different topics, resolutions and all, that would really help with access to information. I have a few proposals for engaging local communities. Number one, making a list of countries who have not participated in the IGF, and then reaching out to those countries, different communities, whether trade associations, technology groups, technical groups, communities, or the governments, and invite them to participate at the IGF. For that, we could possibly do some country workshops as the WISIS forums does or did in the past, That would be like workshops proposed by different countries where they would share information on what's happening in their local communities. Or if we could do like a workshop for LDCs or developing countries or the countries who are not participating at the IGF. So they could be invited to these specific workshops where they could share information about the status of policy and regulatory and other relevant information in their countries in how they could get involved at the IGF process. And they could be provided with some mentorship on how they could be active in the process. The other proposal is with the partnerships. We all come to the meetings and then go back to our countries, and there's no mechanism available for how the different individuals and institutions who are participating at the IGF can connect with each other to share experiences or partner with each other to share knowledge and experience and work on projects to improve the conditions in developing countries specifically. If there is a way, and possibly the Mexico can help with that, to bring the different local communities closer, and that could be by creating an e-portal, a matchmaking sort of a thing, so that people know who's coming to IGF and what are they doing in their local communities, and they can share information on what the other countries need and how they could partner with each other on different issues. And also for the engagement, if there is a separate portal, like there is an interesting platform by the ICANN, which is called myicanN.org, that allows individuals to create an account and access different information about the ICANN process. If we could have something like myIGF or IGF Connect or something like that, which could share that sort of information. And then if there is a way we could translate the system, there is a system which could engage different communities to translate material that are available in English and other languages into local languages, so that people have a better way to access the information. That could help the local startup communities. I know the giants are already involved in the IGF and ICANN processes, but we really need to work very close with the startup communities so they can come up with new ideas, innovative ideas on how we can make internet a better place for all of us. And I really want to all of us to support the process that Hartmut started in Brazil with the youth engagement. We need to support him in the team involved so that we can have a better participation, not only from the Mexico and other developing countries as well. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Omar. And Jutta, I certainly hope I pronounced that correctly, but you have the floor.
Thank you. You pronounced it very well. Thank you. My name is Jutta Kroll. I'm representing the German Center for Child Protection on the Internet and the Digital Opportunities Foundation from Germany. And also, I am founding member of the Dynamic Coalition on Child Online Safety 9 years ago in Brazil, in Rio. As we know from the study that was presented at the last IGF, 1 in 3 of all internet users worldwide is under the age of 18, and when it comes to developing countries, it's 1 in 2 internet users. So that's why I'm raising my voice for their participation as well as their protection when being online on the internet. Children under the age of 18, as they are called in the United Nations Charter of the Rights of the Child, need to be protected from infringement of their rights that are laid down in the UN Charter. So, as in Article 12 and 13, but also 17, the internet can play an important role to ensuring that the rights of the children are protected, and also children need to be protected from harmful content, from contact that they can have on the internet. So when I had a look at the program for the last Internet Governance Forum, as well as for the previous ones, it's quite difficult for youth organizations to justify why they should go to the Internet Governance Forum, because not always the matters that are important to them are mentioned right away in the program. So when we would like to encourage participation of young people, we also need to have their topics right in the program of the IGF, so in the workshop program, but also to be mentioned in the main sessions. That's my point. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Next, Makan, you have the floor.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Makan Fai from the African IGF Secretariat, which is hosted by the Economic Commission for Africa and the African Union. Congratulations, Chair, for I'm just speaking now, and thank you also for Mexico to host the next IGF. We also would like to extend our congratulations and thanks to the IGF Secretariat, UNDESA, especially Shengetai, who has always been providing at the point and excellent support to the MAG members. Africa started its IGF from the Nairobi, African IGF from the Nairobi meeting, and since then we have been organizing annual conferences and participating regularly in the MAG meetings. This year's Global IGF was a success when we look at the track which was organized for the regional and national IGFs. Because we have been organizing every year meetings for national and regional IGFs, but this year really the format and the substance were at the top. I like to come to the SDGs, especially the SDG, which deals with empowering on the gender digital divide. That is, we can see in the outcome documents in several occasions that the digital divide between women and men were linked to the gender divide to the achievement of SDG 5. And the outcome document called for immediate measures to achieve gender equality in internet users by 2020. Especially by significantly enhancing women's and girls' education and participation in information and communication technologies as users, content creators, employees, entrepreneurs, innovators, and leaders. I would like to link this statement from the outcome document to the African Union Framework Agenda 2063 towards creating a more inclusive continent, which highlights the importance of the participation, inclusion, and empowerment of women. In this connection, I would like to let you know that this year has been a celebration of the Women's Day, was used by the African Union to empower women, and would like to make sure that the African IGF this year gives a very important role to women. So we are discussing currently the various sub-teams we would like to have. Presently we have something like empowering women through digital transformation in Africa, enhancing African countries' participation in IGF, building a gender balanced and truly inclusive multi-stakeholder model, inclusive development and the digital transformation of Africa. So we are still thinking of these themes, but we believe that the trend we have now in the discussions is that we are going to really focus on empowering women to benefit from the information and knowledge societies. Thank you.
Thank you, Makan. Marilyn, you have the floor.
Thank you, Madam Chair. My name is Marilyn Kate. I'm going to follow up on a Virat Bhatia's comments and respond a little bit to some of the work that's been going on related to the national and regional IGFs. And so let me note that Anya Genko, who is the fellow who is supporting the ongoing work of the national and regional IGFs, is also acting as remote moderator. But I, as I share briefly some information, there may be an opportunity for Anya to also post some information about our findings so far. During the national and regional IGF coordinators have held a substantive session at each of the IGFs, and they have varied a great deal. There's also been a study that was done a couple of years ago, and last year in preparation for Brazil, we did a rather substantive study with the help of the Secretariat and published it. During the substantive session, the coordinators made concrete recommendations about improvements, and those are available. And we can post those, but I think many of you would find that your comments, when you call for more focus by the national and regional IGFs, when you look at the recommendations that the coordinators made from a real-life perspective, they are really explaining what help they need in order to fulfill their responsibilities and to increase the number of national IGFs. Among the concrete recommendations that they endorsed is to double the number of national IGFs by 2018. And that would go from about 35 to close to 70 national IGFs. They didn't call for doubling the number of world regions, as because there are a limited number of regions. So I just want to point that out. We just did a survey with Anya's help, asking for input about themes and issues. And I will be doing this from memory, so it's going to be important for Anya to be able to post this. But we ask, for instance, for responses, and we gave them 6 or 7 choices and then free text. And among the choices, we included connecting the next billions, phase two. We also included two topics that are related to the SDGs. I think I'm being invited for lunch tomorrow. The two of the topics we asked them about were how are they going to address the SDGs. One of the things I think we're seeing is at the national and regional IGF level, they could use some help in how to translate the importance of the SDGs into the message that will resonate to their community. One of the things, and you've heard this from McCain, but each of the national IGFs is very, very different, and the regionals are very, very different from each other, but they do have commonalities. We found last year that by asking them, by inviting them on a voluntary basis to submit comments on connecting the next billion, we had a very high turnout of comments that were submitted. We asked them to consider holding a session on WSIS Plus 10 review, and we had a very high incorporation of that. But it was on an invitational basis. I think for us to help advance this, it would be good to give some thought to what would we suggest to a national or regional IGF about a session that they might hold about how the SDGs relate to internet governance and explain what is in the outcome document. Many of them are brand new, and I'm looking at people in this room who are themselves thinking about launching an IGF yet this year. And I think if we could think about a little bit of packaging, if I might call it that, to support Omar's comments and to build. Now, finally, I'm going to wrap up by saying I really want to fully endorse what I think Bharat was saying. I frankly do not think it is a good use of the MAG members' time to do a evaluation on where we are in the improvements. I think that's the Secretariat's job. I think a call to action where the MAG could really make a difference is to make a commitment, just as the national and regional coordinators did, to double the number of national IGFs. Let's make a MAG commitment to significantly increase the focus of all stakeholders from developing countries in the IGF.
Thank you, Marilyn, and thank you for persevering through the mic. Cheryl, you have the floor.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Just to follow up on a comment that Hossam made earlier with respect to looking at this as a 10-year block, I think that's extremely telling and valuable and wise. We should really be thinking about that. And Omar also made some comments with respect to how do we engage some of the countries that have never participated before. And he had some very good ideas, and I wanted to build off of that a little bit. I think the point about the host country website coming out late actually is a really good one, because we're already 6 or 7 months away, but how do you keep people interested and kind of build momentum? So I don't know if there's a way, perhaps, if the website's not ready, perhaps we can find a way to maybe post a short monthly video or something along the lines of that, where, you know, we'll be giving some sort of information to the general public, but we'll also be building that momentum and getting people excited. In addition, perhaps through the youth program, I think I've heard overwhelming support for the youth program. Perhaps we can prioritize and try to first support youth from those countries where there's never been any participation to actually come to the IGF. Along those lines, perhaps we can also try to find a way to reach out and engage individuals within those countries to try to submit proposals and try to work with them to actually have some of their workshop proposals at this year's IGF. Along those lines as well, I just want to really highlight diversity in the youth program is we really need to make sure that we maintain that in order for it to be successful long term. And I think each individual stakeholder group can help with that in terms of the outreach and reaching out to their own stakeholders and building sort of that support and excitement for the event that'll take place at the end of the year. Thank you.
Thank you, Cheryl. Cisse, you have the floor.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Regarding SDGs and possible improvement, I first would like to congratulate you and this for this review, which was very relevant. What I see from that is that there is a lot to do regarding Africa, especially in terms of implementation of the WSIS outcomes. And when I link it to SDGs, I see that one of the aspects that could be relevant is to organize the information in the way that it is digested by population at a larger scale. Here in this room, we are all maybe specialists or very well-educated people. But when it comes to taking the information to the grassroots, there will be a need to organize the information. And that's why I really applaud this initiative of Diplo, making people having access to this tremendous amount of information in a way, because it is well organized.
visit our website at
because it is organized in a way that
webex.co.uk.
Sorry. So the information is organized and it's very useful. And for example, in our website, we just tried something. We tried to collect all the IGFs, national, regional, and global in Africa for 2015. And we put them on the website. So if you go there, you can see all the national IGFs. And is there a way to create sort of a database in this way? And Axis is willing to contribute to develop a comprehensive database for Africa. And I think this is one of the way we can improve the work of the MAG. And also regarding VCs, there is a problem of implementation. And sharing information is one of the key elements. And the best way to go through this information sharing and to have comprehensive data is, as I said this morning, is to depart from national IGFs, to implement it, to advertise for it, and to look for potential partners at a grassroots level to develop local and national IGFs. And I support Marilyn in this way. Thank you.
Thank you, Cisse. We were fortunate late last year that the Secretariat was able to add a staff specifically in IT. That is, in fact, Luis here on the hand. So the Secretariat is taking a note of some of the requests, including all the other requests that have come in with respect to kind of web presence and website. We're not going to respond to each one of them individually on the fly here, but they are noting them. So Juan, you have the floor.
Thank you. Being the first time that I take the floor, I will identify myself. I'm Juan Fernandez. I'm from government of Cuba. And so let me give my welcome to the new MAG members. This is my second year, and especially the welcome to our new chair. And I'm looking forward to work with all of you for fulfilling our mandate. In this sense, I will take just a few minutes now, taking into advantage that the host country representative is here, because some of the things I will go tomorrow when we're discussing the themes and all that. But what I heard from previous speakers, especially Marilyn and the lady who spoke about a child, I want to remind that this is not another internet event. There are many internet events where they showcase best practice, and that has happened all the time throughout the world. As a matter of fact, in Cuba, we have one each 2 years. A few weeks ago, it was one. This, if you remember the mandate of the IGF, this is for policy dialogue. And we have to remember that, because one of the key that could make people interested to participate is if that the issue that is being discussed, for instance, I will put an example, if a child writes, if they think that this will be discussed, of course, the idea will be to reach a consensus, but well, even if does it not reach, is to hear the positions, to approximate those positions. And so people that are interested in those issues, you know, with the hope to emerge a policy in some place that is not already agreed. So that could interest people. And I think that we as MAG, we have to guide this process. We have to select which area. Tomorrow we will speak about that, because there are ways that we can do it. We can just leave it open and do this selection as when we select the workshops, or we can put the themes out and ask for that. Tomorrow we will discuss that. But because the key thing of the IGF is to do this policy dialogue from the diversity of not only stakeholders, but different regions, as Marilyn said, that each one has their own particularity, and many countries. And so that's why each IGF has to be different, because it's in a different host country, in a different place. And One of the things important to try to help with this policy dialogue is that we need concepts and we need some guidance. And in the region, that's why I'm talking now to the host country, and I don't know if the secretariat as well. We are lucky that we have the Economic Commission for Latin America and the Caribbean, ECLAC, that has been done tremendous work in some of the key concepts of the contemporary economy. You remember in João Pessoa, there was Raul Katz, one of the specialists of this area that has done work for ECLAC before, and there's some others. So I suggest that the host country for some of the events, and because I saw that this is one of the points of the agenda now of different initiatives or whatever to go, that to approach ECLAC to have a stronger participation or guidance, or maybe the secretariat, I don't know, I'm just making this suggestion, to involve them in some of this planning of one of the sessions or whatever, because it could be the base for any other dialogue in policy. And concerning the concrete way that us, MAG, has to work, I think that tomorrow is in the agenda for the themes and that, so I will come back to this point tomorrow. Thank you.
Thank you, Juan. Jovan, you have the floor.
Thank you, Jovan Kurbelia. Just a few reflections on the overall discussion and quite a few interesting ideas on linking IG discussion and sustainable development goals. Probably one of the major challenges will be sort of cross-silos approach, and this has been outlined in the SDG discussion, that dealing with specific issues, let's say poverty, education, other SDGs, within the silos provides suboptimal results. Now, internet and ICT comes as, I always say, ghost SDG. It's not explicitly mentioned, a specific SDG. It is SDG that affects all SDGs, and it will have the major challenge, even bigger than traditional SDGs, to overcome policy silos. Now, when it comes to practicalities, what Merlin mentioned, Sis, and other colleagues, it relates to explaining to policy communities on national, regional, and global level why internet and ICT matters for their dealing with agriculture, health, poverty reduction, specific SDGs. Now, there are no sort of a magic solution for it. The key is the engagement. And the key is to find what we call at Diplo boundary spanners. And ideally, IGF members and MAG members should be boundary spanners. Going to the communities and explaining that when they discuss agriculture in their respective countries, they're also discussing certain ICT policy issues. This is the real challenge. We have one simple experiment that could be used further, and we are so far it's developing very well with Brazil and Indonesia, and we are discussing with a few other countries, is development of the national hubs that meet once a month, last Tuesday in the month at 11 o'clock GMT. They get together in their national hubs and discuss exactly these issues, how to implement IG and how to develop links between different policy silos. You know, the policy silos is one of the most frequently used terms in Geneva, and probably very little, you know, the theory, one of the golden rules, the more it's mentioned, the least it is addressed substantively. And probably the way how to address is to have the groundwork, door by door, community by community, simple issues, addressing concrete issues. On the question which I guess Omar mentioned, how many countries participated, we did statistics till IGF 2011. We analyzed all transcripts from MAG and the main meeting. There were 56 countries which participated, not only government, civil society, business, from 56 countries. It improved. We are finalizing research till the last IGF to
to approximately slightly more than 100 countries, representatives from those countries, who made any intervention and meeting like this one or official IGF meeting. The main challenge is not necessarily to have more numbers. The main challenge is to have substantive input, which relates to the problems that should be addressed. And here we come to probably the key objective that we should to add to capacity development. It is institutional capacity development. I think ISOC, IGF, summer school, VA Diplo did quite a good work on developing individual capacity development, training people to participate in IG meetings, but there are very, very little efforts to have institutional capacity development. Therefore, to have the continuity of initiatives, to have a strength within the ministries, within civil society organizations, business sector. And this could be probably the link between IG and SDG that we should develop more, institutional capacity development. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you, Jovan. The next speaker is, and I probably should apologize in advance for the pronunciation here, Morgiano.
Thank you. First, I would like to congratulate you as the new MAC chair. The second thing is, I would like to thanks to Brazil as the host of the last IGF meeting. And the third one is congratulations also to Mexico as the next IGF host meeting. And this time, I would like to propose one thing for tomorrow's meeting, i.e. for the selection of the topics, main topics or the topics of workshops. After we discuss the main topics, usually we choose the workshops topics, and we have so many titles for the workshops. I would like to propose that we can list the two or more topics which is very close, and then we talk to the country who proposed the topics, and then we try to merge one topics for the several topics. And then the next thing, we have to choose from several MAC IGF meeting. Okay, thank you.
Thank you. And Virat, you have the floor.
I just wanted to make a quick point. I think, firstly, on the point that Shwan made, the chair summary for the 2014 Istanbul does record 144 country nationals participating at the IGF. So I think that is the record high that we've had. This is across all sectors. So there is much to celebrate. And if that is true, then that would mean that about 50-odd countries of the U.S. member states weren't at that meeting, but they probably were at some other meeting. So the numbers are quite encouraging when 144 is three-fourths of the entire UN member states. I was on the issue of SDGs and when the way to bring it in. One of the ways to draw in governments and the policy dialogue that was alluded to make it interesting is to think about a WISIS plus 10 type consultation that Madeline held very successfully at Brazil, which I watched online, is to, if we can use the year or the 6 month period to get a dialogue going with national, regional IGFs, countries, government stakeholders, to bring in presentations on how they think they are using internet for delivering SDGs. I think we have to make it really simple for them. I would argue that internet is actually the silo buster. It is the one common medium that is at least relevant to many of the 169 sub SDGs that exist there. And I did finally lay my hands on the letter that was sent out by on 27th of July, where one of the directions that was given, sort of request that was made to the MAG by the Undersecretary General, was that both the Secretary General and the member states have underscored the important role that internet can play in advancing SDGs. So I think there is a very clear approach that is on at national levels. I think it would be really up to us to use the year to galvanize those efforts, bring them up, and have them present with pride what they're doing. I don't think we should sort of give them policy prescriptions. I think they've figured out how this thing is working. A lot of youth are involved. Governments are completely on board on this one. We can, in the process, have some engagement and discussion and capacity building. But I think we should also provide them a platform. If the MAG agrees as a major outcome in Mexico, to see if we can invite the sort of multi-stakeholder view of using internet to deliver SDGs and what is happening at local level. It could be 2-minute interventions of the kind that Madeline provided. If we can plan our session well, it can go over 3 hours. But I think that would kind of give us, as a community, maybe 50 views, 70 views, 80 views of countries on what's going on right now. And they're also then probably invited to submit a 5-pager behind that, which could then become a document that could bind together and be available for consultation and discussion across various stakeholders. So we could sort of, I'm just thinking of practical ways in which we can really take this down using our platform to invite them to listen to what they're doing rather than tell them how to do this. Thank you.
No, thank you, Virat. And now we have an online participant.
Thank you, Madam Chair. We have one comment that I will read, and after that we're going to have one intervention. So from Shita Lakshmi, to add the current discussion on how to engage regional and national IGFs, we can think of adding social media campaign on it, one designated website for the database of all regional and national IGFs, and continuous conversation via social media. It will be very helpful for people who access social media frequently, especially those who live in Southeast Asia. And after this, Chris Buckridge. Chris, I'm going to unmute you now.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes.
Hi. Thank you, Madam Chair. This is Chris Buckridge from the RIPE NCC. I'd like to start by congratulating all of the new members to the MAG. We're sure that you're all going to do a fine job, and it's a very important job in this context. One thing I want to note, though, is that the recent announcement of the new MAG prompted some discussion, particularly in the technical community, about the processes and of selection and nomination for these MAG members. I think this is an issue that's going to be discussed in tomorrow's MAG discussion, but we wanted to note it here in the open consultation as well. And the RIPE NCC particularly is quite concerned at the lack of transparency in this process. It wasn't clear to us who nominated some of the representatives that were appointed to the MAG or how that selection process was conducted. We understand this is a really complex process. An earlier speaker noted the strength of developing country participation in the MAG this time around, and that's very positive, obviously. And obviously, there's also a huge challenge for the UN in selecting appropriate representatives from a global stakeholder group. But all of these points, I think, highlight that transparency is really vital in ensuring that this process is fair and legitimate. So, thank you.
Thank you, Chris. Izumi, you have the floor.
Thank you, Madam Chair.
Well, coming from the technical community, I really echo the issue that Chris has raised. But the reason that I raised my hand is for a separate topic. So while I am participating as a MAG member, I am also involved in the national IGF within Japan, Internet Governance Conference Japan, IGCJ. So I really like the point that Virat has raised about encouraging participation from national IGF as a way to have more inputs from the LDCs. I also want to add that it's not just the LDC that has limited participation, but then from the countries that has a little bit of different culture of this kind of style of discussions. For example, Japan is not LDC, but I don't think we've really had substantial input in the IGF meeting from Japan, and this has been a challenge. So I want to make a consider how exactly we can improve this in a practical way, or possibly start consideration from this year. And based on my experience and observation, it actually took me 3 years, starting from my term at the MAG, to get the Japanese community be aware of the IGF itself, what relevance it has. And then this year, they have finally started discussing. So how can we actually actively provide input? So this is really long-term process. We can't just share about the meeting or agenda. You have to take a step back, saying, hey, this is important in the wider context and why it is important in each of the economies. And I think each of the countries have different contexts and why this is important for them. So as a way forward, I really like the idea that was shared by Jovan about having like a monthly call by national IGFs or like each leaders in the economy. So as a MAG, possibly, maybe after each like MAG meeting or key decision is made, give an overall view of okay, what were the key outcomes from IGF last year, and what is at this stage, and what kind of involvement and input would be useful. And then encourage, invite leaders, for example, people from the national, the leaders from the national IGF or any other key organizations from different stakeholder groups to invite this kind of webinar kind of meeting. And they can actually go back and think what is relevant from their perspective. And I think if we can actually also consider the suggestion from Virat that based on those discussions in each economies, bring it back to the global IGF and have their contributions, I think that would actually provide a good segue for conversation both ways. Thank you.
Thank you, Izumi. Gentleman way in the back. You have the floor, and if you could introduce yourself.
Okay.
Okay, Segun, you can.
Okay, can I go ahead?
Yes, please, Segun, you have the floor.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I want to lend my voice to the discussion on the need to encourage a national initiative. I would like to bring it to your notice that I'm representing a business community. I come from Nigeria, an affluent of Africa. But I'm surprised that Nigerian government has been dropped from being a member of MAG. And the reason why I'm quite surprised is that Nigeria is a regional leader in West African country. And they have the most vibrant internet governance forum at the local level. And not only that, the country has been sponsoring regional Internet Governance Forum and the West African Forum. So if such country is not encouraged to be part of the MAG, where they could share the experience and all that, I'm surprised that we are talking about facilitating and encouraging a regional or a national initiative. Now, you have the one that has been working in the last 4 years. We're even at the point of discussing the need on how Nigeria can host IGF probably in 2018 and 19. But when the announcement came, the local initiative in Nigeria, they are not happy that even a representative of the government of Nigeria is not considered, in spite of the investment that the country has made in advocating and ensuring that the internet governance framework is well established in West African region. So these are the issues I really want us to look at, because if you are not including a regional leader, a MAG, then who are you going to include? Thank you.
Wyman, would you like to respond to that specific question?
Let me just respond to that, this general concern that I've heard. In terms of the MAG selection process, it's not done in a different way from past years. As you all know, there's the MAG members now, there are 55 members. So, and the current practice is actually to rotate out 1/3. So for the 2016 MAG, there was a vacancy of 22 slots. And we did receive a total of 182 nominations, some of which are duplicates. So I think it's actually a very challenging process to see exactly who should be should took up these available vacancies. And one thing which highlighted by some of you is that the in terms of geographical representations, it's actually important to look at across all stakeholder groups. Unlike a typical UN body, of course, it's the emphasis is placed on government, but IGF itself is unique, so is MAG. So it's actually the balance across the different stakeholder groups. But there is certainly an attempt, which is not just this year and past year as well, to increase the number of developing countries, which I think some of you have shared the statistic. Secondly, it's also on gender and also on stakeholder groups. The stakeholder groups is also quite an issue to understand exactly what constitute stakeholder representations. What does it mean by in the technical community versus civil society versus private sector? And I think a lot of you are also taking on double, if not multiple hats, which is across sectors as well. So these are some of the challenges. But I can certainly say that on behalf of DESA, we very much invite you to give your views, your contributions. We recognize that this is not a perfect system, including like the MAG. Why? Any reason that we have 55 members now? Should we increase the number, decrease the number? The MAG term, 3 years, should we reduce to 2 years so that we can give more the opportunity to participate? Now the practice to rotate out 1/3. Should we do more of that or less of that? So this is the whole series of questions that we certainly invite you all to give your views.
Thank you, Wyman. And Changatai has asked for the floor as well.
Just to add a little bit more, for the MAG renewal, I think we'll touch on this more tomorrow, is that we do have what we termed a MAG scorecard, where we just track very likely the contribution of each MAG member, whether they attend the meetings, do the workshop grading and things like that. So you may find that some MAG members will only last 1 year in the MAG instead of the proposed maximum of 3 years because they didn't participate at all in any of the MAG activities. But that's for tomorrow's discussion when we go through the responsibilities for MAG members. Thanks.
So we're going to go back to the queue in a moment. But I think I'd like to say that, Wyman invited people to engage in a discussion. I know there have been a lot of questions and comments and discussions on lists, not only with respect to the appointment of MAG members, but also with respect to the appointment of the chair. And I think this is a good time as a community to engage with UNDESA if we have questions and concerns. I think we're all involved in processes that can be improved from day to day and year to year. And this may actually be an appropriate time to start looking at some of those going forward. I think my only caution, and a few of the MAG members mentioned this earlier today, is that we need to, of course, pay primary attention to the fact that we actually have a program to deliver in a relatively short period of time. And some of these things probably are better served by thoughtful, inclusive discussions and maybe work that we do in the background to progress. But I just want to point out that Iman was very open, and he did actually say that he was willing to engage if there were questions. So with that, I'm going to go to the gentleman in the back, if you'd introduce yourself, and then I think we have Laura in the back. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Jivan from Macedonia. Before I start, a joke comes to mind, and you know, in the US, they like to start with jokes. So the joke is of a drunken man. He's walking around the street, and he's looking for his keys. Another person comes along, and he's asking him, "What are you looking for? My keys. Well, where did you lose them? Somewhere over there. But why are you looking for them over here? Well, the light is here. The street light is here." And what goes, what is true for a drunken man looking for his keys might be true for people also maybe walking around on a dark street. They will get around the light to discuss whatever they have to discuss. And I think that that is something that the IGF needs to do well. And it has been doing it for the past 10 years, and it should do it for the next 10 years, to know exactly what to throw a light on. To know exactly what kind of policy dialogues and discussions to engage in and what to throw a focus on. And I always hear very good contributions in that we should increase participation. And of course, this is a very important part that we need to do. But at the same time, there's a limit to how much information we can gather. I think that both in the document that I shared via email a few days ago and has been mentioned here as well, a very important thing that we need to do is the packaging of the things that are coming out of the IGF as outcomes, the dissemination of that data and in all of our communities, and then getting from those communities what are the problems that they're facing, and then to see what are the proper institutions that can solve them, and delivering the discussions that are coming in the IGFs as discussions, as possibilities, as debates, and that is what the IGF can do well. And I think that there has been a lot of worry over the years that the IGF doesn't become a body that duplicates the work of any other communities that have done their work so well over the years. And I would bet, even though that it has been a worry, and perhaps a worry that has been concentrated on governments, I would bet that in this room, including the government representatives, there is no one who wants to duplicate the work of other organizations that are doing their job so well. But there is a role that IGF can play in routing information, in focusing, in packaging. And I think that now is a good time, just as we're starting to think about Mexico, to start thinking about the next 10 years. And I would really encourage us to devote at least 20% of our time, 15% of our time, not just to keeping the aim of Mexico, but really on the long-term focus of what the IGF can be and how we can improve. And I think that would be worthwhile. Thanks. Oh, by the way, sorry, I couldn't come this morning. I jumped in. So could someone give me the Wi-Fi code?
Thank you, Jivan. Laura, you have the floor.
Is that better? Sorry, I thought I turned it on. My name's Laura Hutchison. I'm from Nominet. I'm a new MAG member on behalf of the technical community. I'm very pleased to have been appointed. Thank you very much. I wanted to talk about engagement with regional national IGFs. As we've kind of spoken about the MAG appointment process, I wanted to just make a comment on that. I just found, as someone that's recently been in the process, I just found some of the communication lacking in terms of timescales and processes. And I actually heard about my appointment on a news article before I was told. But I was very pleased to have been appointed. Coming back to the topic of regional national engagement, I recognise that a lot of steps have already been made in this direction. I wanted to highlight the work that Marilyn's mentioned that's been coordinated by Anya on the surveys of the regional nationals to suggest topics. I think that's a kind of key way to make sure that topics are feeding up from the regional national areas up into the global IGF. I also had a practical suggestion. Several years ago, when we made a submission on behalf of the UK IGF for workshop speakers, we were suggesting topics that we'd covered on a UK, in the UK arena, such as, I don't know, say cybersecurity. But when we came to meeting the requirements for a workshop in terms of global representation, that was where we struggled in terms of how do I know who is an expert on cybersecurity from Asia or Africa? So maybe having to build on the resource facilities that are on the UK, on the IGF website already, whether there could be some linkages with the regional, national, in terms of topic area and subject experts. Thank you.
Thank you, Laura. Anya, we'll go to an online participant.
Yeah, we have two comments. Ginger Peck, Civil Society, and for the Civil Society Coordination Group. I would like to strongly support Chris' points that we must address MAG selection processes and transparency and ask that we ensure time to discuss this tomorrow. Second comment is from Shiva Subramanian. I have, in the course of the past 3 years, observed that there might be a possibility that the collective opinion that emerges on workshop proposals occasionally reflect an orchestrated opinion or even an unseen prejudice on certain topics or ideas. This is possibly a perception that it is wrong, but attention to such a likelihood and a clear and transparent review process on workshop decisions could ensure that there are no prejudices. Renata would like to speak, so I'm going to mute her now.
Hello, everyone. This is Renata Kinahibiru from Brazil, new MAG member representing the society. I am grateful to speak to this audience. I would also like to congratulate the new chair and the new MAG members. And I would ask of all those involved in the witness processes of New York and the next meeting in May in Geneva, if we could address more the witness sections and engage them with the IGF process. The way I see it, this is all a continuum in the
Thank you, Renata, and thank you, Anya. Next, Cheryl, you have the floor.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I just wanted to go back briefly to, I think it was Virat's proposal with respect to linking closer to the SDGs. Along those lines, I think another important component, and I'm not sure how we could go about gathering this information, but to be able to somehow gain a better understanding about what the countries who aren't participating, what they care about most, what are the issues that they're most concerned with. I think also, as I just have the website pulled up in front of us, we all are such, I don't want to use the word insider, but we live and breathe this every day. And I try to sometimes go to the site and imagine myself as a person who didn't know what the IGF was, and pulling up that page, what would my value proposition be? What? Why would I, you know, exert the time, the money, and energy to go. It's obvious to all of us, but I think perhaps in terms of our marketing, we can have some, you know, maybe more simple, I don't know if simple is the best word, but a different way of packaging it to just people, not internet experts, not, you know, just regular doctors, teachers, you know, EMT, whoever the case may be, but just to think of it, how would we package it to just the average citizen globally? And then finally, I think with respect to the governments, if we can start to brainstorm about different incentives for getting them in the room, I think there is a whole range of ministers that we're not reaching. So for example, the finance ministers, the health ministers, et cetera, to try to create a value proposition for them. I mean, maybe we incorporate something into the day zero events that kind of brings them all together with respect to dialogue. Maybe we host something on looking at the investment aspect of some of the connectivity issues that they care about. Just a couple of ideas that I thought I would just throw out there. Thank you.
No, thank you, Cheryl. Next, Christine has the floor. Okay, Christina.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Christina Monti from the European Commission. I thought I would share with you some remarks concerning the outcomes of the World Summit WISIS Plus 10 review and the outcome of last year from the perspective of the European Commission. But in general, I think that also echoing what some of the previous speakers have said, the final text is considered positively by the majority of stakeholders, and it provides a good base for our work and also for internet governance discussions for the next 10 years. So we are aware that the text recognizes the importance of the digital economy, the respective roles of private and public sector in its development, and of course it connects ICTs to sustainable development goals. And we are talking a lot about this and how to transform this vision in reality, how to implement this. So capacity building and development are for sure very important. At the same time, also let's consider the digital economy aspect. This year, there was the World Economic Forum at Davos, which was devoted to the topic of the fourth industrial revolution. The World Bank issued a report in January that addresses the digital economy. Also, the G7 will have a ministerial on ICT, and as well the G20 in China will have a session on the digital economy. So my point is really that this could be a way also to connect more to other sectors, and other sectors meaning sectors of the economy as well, like health or agriculture. It could be, you know, all sectors that are impacted by the new technologies and for which we should somehow connect maybe strongly the work of the IGF to also those initiatives and those discussions that are happening at the global level and which also touch on the internet and on internet governance. And it is just a manifestation of the fact that technologies are now pervasive and touching all aspects of our lives and our economies and of our everyday lives. Also, the European Dialogue on Internet Governance, which will take place in Brussels in June, has chosen as a topic embracing the digital revolution, so also to highlight these changes that are now happening at that and that will have an impact. So this is just my contribution. Thank you.
Thank you, Christine. Sala, you have the floor.
Thank you, Madam Chair. This is Sala for the record. Sala for the record. Thank you, Madam Chair. I would just like to add to the discussion by sort of echoing some of the things or some of the sentiments that are coming out, particularly in terms of the linkages between the national IGFs and the regional IGFs. I think Marilyn pointed it out this morning. I'd also like to mention that before coming to Geneva, I took the liberty to sort of launch a Survey Monkey within the Asia Pacific and sort of send several questions to various mailing lists, particularly those within the internet governance ecosystem. And because of the short span of time, we had 25 respondents. But interestingly, a lot of them, this is what they sort of had to say. And again, this is not exhaustive, but it's sort of like a barometer. 36% said that they've attended an IGF meeting. 64% said they hadn't. In terms of whether they'd attended an Asia-Pacific regional IGF, 33.3 said yes, 58.3 said no, 20.83 said, I've never heard of an Asia Pacific Regional Internet IGF. 16.67 said, I'm aware of the Asia Pacific Regional IGF, but it's too expensive to attend. And in terms of questions on, do you think issues that concern the Pacific are tabled within the Asia Pacific Regional IGF? 45% yes, 60% said no. And do you think issues that concern Asia are discussed within the Asia-Pacific Regional IGF? 72.22% said yes, 33.33% said no. Because of the brevity of time, I'll just post a link on the MEG mailing list so that you can have a look at the figures yourself. But it does sort of point to the, in essence, what the community within the Asia Pacific, at least the respondents who responded, sort of said is, look, we recognize the importance of the IGF. We want to have the IGF, but it's just that we're having difficulties. And there's a lot of room, particularly for the regional IGFs to take ownership of the outreach, particularly within their region. And the other thing I'd also like to add is, in terms of what's been discussed so far, one of the things that we can sort of consider is there's a need to strengthen existing dynamic coalitions and use the dynamic coalitions to diversify and build. They're already doing it, but to build on thematic knowledge hubs that are linked with the SDGs, and particularly in terms of the cross flows, bottom up. I shouldn't even say bottom up because it's fluid. It's not vertical. It's something. It's an ecosystem. And the other thing also related to that is standardizing dynamic coalition reports and outcomes and linking their works with local and national IGFs and regional IGFs. And I'd just like to ride on Jovan's comment in terms of when he mentioned institutionalizing capacity building. From personal experience, in 2014, and this is in the Pacific where I'm from, we had the Pacific Platform, and the Pacific Platform within the disaster response or disaster mitigation space, along with the other regions in the world, they were doing the Asia Platform, the African Platform, which was moving towards the Sendai framework that was passed last year. Believe it or not, I had a difficult time, even though there were many people who actually involved in ICT, but a lot more in the climatic change, a lot more in the disaster response space. I had a severely difficult time getting ICT into the outcomes document. Because what their perception of ICT, and I know I'm using ICT, but you can include internet governance, their perception of ICT as far as my region was concerned in terms of that particular niche was that ICT is just, you know, oh, it's desk support. Oh, it's, you know, promotional and marketing and that sort of thing. So in terms of Jovan's suggestion about the cross-silo strategy, I think that's certainly something that we should consider, particularly in terms of looking at ways to get get fluidity within the discussions. And that's all I'd like to say, Chair.
Thank you, Sala. We have six more people in the queue, and you know who you are because your flags are up, seven, and then I'm actually going to eight online participation. And then we're going to move to the final agenda item. We have some people that have actually asked for interventions from other organizations. We want to make sure we have enough time to both feature those and engage in discussions if appropriate. So, Marcus, you have the floor.
Thank you, Lynn. Marcus Comer speaking. I'm taking the floor in my capacity as Secretary of the IGF Support Association. As many speakers have mentioned the importance of national and regional IGF initiatives, I thought I'd come in at this stage. The IGF Support Association also is part of its rationale behind its existence is that we are here to support national and regional IGF initiatives. Last year, we supported 15 national IGF initiatives with a small contribution and seven regional and sub-regional ones as well. The contributions are modest, but the aim is to allow them to invite speakers, and most of them invited speakers from within their regions and participants, and we make very limited conditionalities, essentially aiming to link them closer to the main IGF through the IGF secretariat. It's very much in line what Marilyn referred to with the coordination efforts and the call the IGF secretariat is supporting, so that we have a minimum coherence among them, that they all adhere to some basic principles, that they are open, inclusive, and bottom-up. And we would hope that this contributes to more flow of information between the national and regional IGF initiatives and the global IGF. And we would hope that the themes bubble up from the bottom and enrich the themes of the global IGF, not the other way around, that the global IGF dictates the themes for the national and regional IGFs. Thank you.
Thank you, Marcus. Zumi, you have the floor.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I would like to touch on the MAG selection process. And I find it very helpful that there has been immediate clarification from the UN DESA about this year's process. So thank you very much. And I think transparency is the key here. It's not just for the selection of the MAG members itself, but also for the future of the IGF, including IGF modalities, location of the secretariat, or any other key decisions around the organization of the IGF. And I think the meeting, the IGF, the physical meeting itself is based on transparent discussions. Also, the MAG meeting is transparent, and this actually adds to credibility of our discussions. So it is important to have a transparency on any other elements that will actually build up to the organization of the IGF. And I also think that these issues get discussed in open consultation, where non-MAG members can also participate in discussions versus the MAG meeting itself. And I think to just quickly touch on the comment that has been made that there has been no changes in the process for this year compared to the past. This is noted and understood. At the same time, I observed that there has been some questions about people who are interested in applying for the MAG this year. Hey, what is exactly the process of application? I received these questions individually. So I think having more clarity does help. And I'm looking forward to further discussions about how we can implement the improvements for the discussions for tomorrow. Thank you.
Thank you, Izumi. Elizabeth, you have the floor.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Elizabeth Thomas Reno speaking on behalf of the private sector. I actually am grateful, Izumi, your comments touch exactly on one of the points that I wanted to make. One of them was actually a clarification of the agenda discussion. I wasn't very clear whether I welcomed the invitation from our colleague from UNDESA to share feedback and reflections on this process. I wasn't clear whether this was something we were going to tackle in our agenda this afternoon or whether we would be trying to fit it in another occasion. I do think it is worth some reflection and some exchange on, but share the same concerns raised by the MAG chair that we don't lose time when we're in a very delicate situation. So I would be keen to find it the right spot in the agenda. I would also support the remarks that Izumi made on the need for transparency and clarity of expectations. I think that this is just really important for us to constantly reinforce in the work that we do together. What I have noted in looking through experiences of colleagues from the past is that it seems with the IGF MAG processes, it's almost been like an English legal system where it's creating informal processes that are over time creating sort of a body of precedent and norms. And so if that is what we're doing and where we are, I think it's great to have those clearly articulated. If they're evolving and changing, or we want them to evolve and change, I very much welcome an open discussion about that. I would echo the point Izumi made that I think that open discussion would be better in today's schedule, where we have the full community of people who are interested and not just a self-determination among MAG members. I think that open discussion would be more valuable with other people participating. Our own experience, as I convene a lot of the private sector through the ICC Basis Initiative, our own experience has been that where we receive explicit guidance in terms of where the gaps are in private sector representation, be it around gender or expertise or geography, for other processes that we have participated in, the extent to which that can be extremely clear in advance of our culling possible candidates and going through our nomination process, that's been very helpful. We've had a recent experience with the CSTD working group, and the chair was quite explicit on what those were, and that helped us a lot in our call for candidates. So I would encourage future processes and you and Dessa explicitly to share that feedback with us in advance. I think also cultivating people with the knowledge and understanding of the IGF well before the month that we are asked for candidates is something that we all need to do as different communities. But to help us do that, I think the more information that we have about where the gaps are, that would be helpful. And then on a separate point, I just wanted to support what our colleague from the European Union made, the point she made about the importance of the relationship between the activities that are going on to foster and promote digital economic development and the sustainable development goals. We had a very, I think, positive experience at the IGF in Brazil with the main session on the internet economy and sustainable development, then leading to cooperation between ICC Basis and the African Union, where we were able to do a similar side event in alongside the WISIS event, and that has also encouraged future events to be proposed. So I think this is exactly the kind of thing that shows there's meaningful connections to what we do in the IGF and other venues, and that we can feed each other with valuable substance. Thank you.
Thank you, Elizabeth. I think to your question on the agenda, I mean, this is the open consultation, and there have been a couple of comments at least on some of the processes and the need to discuss them further. There is some time on the agenda tomorrow. We'll have to take a look at the agenda, and I think the feedback we got today to understand that, but this is the appropriate time for members of the community to. So we have another five or so people in the queue, and then we'll move on to the fourth item, having said that. The next in the queue is a gentleman from the ITU.
Yes, thank you, Madam Chairman. I wanted to pick the proper agenda item, but I see that the statements from the floor are pretty mixed up, so there is not a wrong agenda item at the end. My name is Vladimir Stankovic, and I have a pleasure to address you on behalf of International Telecommunication Union, and I'd like to share with you details of the upcoming WISIS Forum 2016. It will be held from 2nd to 6th of May, and we expect more than 1,500 stakeholders from over 140 countries, including more than 100 ministers, ambassadors, heads of agencies, CEOs, and high-level representatives from the private sector, civil society, and academia. We invite you all to block these days on your calendar and visit the dedicated website for detailed information. The forum builds upon the outcomes of the UN General Assembly overall review of the implementation of the WISIS outcomes, which recognized the necessity of holding this forum on an annual basis and called for a close alignment between WISIS and the Sustainable Development Goals processes. The VSIS forum will therefore serve as a key forum for discussing the role of ICTs as a means of implementation of the Sustainable Development Goals and targets. With due regard to the global mechanism for follow-up and review of the implementation of the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development. The Secretary General of ITU had several consultations with member states, and upon that, Mr. Daniel Sepulveda, Deputy Assistant Secretary of the State and the U.S. Coordinator for International Communications and Information Policy of the United States of America, has been designated as the Chairman of VSIS Forum 2016. The Chairman designate will be officially appointed on the 3rd of May during the opening ceremony. Highlighting real projects from the ground that are implementing the potential of ICTs for sustainable development, on the 3rd of May, the annual VSIS Prize ceremony will be held, where winners will be rewarded for the excellence in the implementation of VSIS outcomes. Appreciating the activities of the stakeholders, this year we will also be recognizing 70 champions who were the 5 best voted in the online voting phase in each action line category. For the first time, VSIS Forum is introducing TEDx Talks together with TEDx Geneva, and this will bridge VSIS process to the new vibrant community of 100 plus million online followers and will address cutting edge topics related to development and technology. While exploring the new horizons, which is the title of these talks towards sustainable development, it's our common interest to leave no one behind. This event will take place on 3rd of May in CICG, starting at 6 p.m. The agenda of the VSIS Forum 2016 is available online, as you're aware, and the agenda is built from the submissions received from the stakeholders during the open consultation process. We are proud to share with you that the innovative and content-rich agenda of the VSIS Forum 2016 builds upon more than 150 submissions. This is indeed a truly collaborative activity where the VSIS stakeholders build the agenda together and bring forth the most pressing issues in each action line for multi-stakeholder discussions and dialogues. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you. Mike Nelson has the floor, but it looks as though he stepped out for a moment, so we'll put him to the back of the queue. Mark Carvel, you have the floor.
Thank you, Chair. Mark Carvel, United Kingdom Government. I just wanted to make 3 quick points, as I know time's short. Firstly, on youth participation, one of the messages that came out strongly from Jean Pessoa was that young people needed to be integrated into the IGF program as much as possible. And I hope the new MAG will be able to send a clear message to main session and also workshop organizers that they consider the involvement of a young person as a participant on a panel or whatever the session mechanism is in terms of active participation. Second point, online child protection. The UK government feels this is a very important issue for the IGF. We hope very much that the MAG will ensure that online child protection has a prominent place in the IGF program for Guadalajara. Bearing in mind, though, it is a bottom-up process, but I hope the MAG will be able to ensure that that important global issue does have some profile in the program for Guadalajara. My third point is with regard to the G7 ICT Ministerial Conference. I'm the lead UK official in preparation for that. The ministerial conference itself is a closed session, but there will be a multi-stakeholder conference on the first day, which is the 29th of April, the end of this month. This multi-stakeholder conference is co-organized by the Japanese Ministry of Internal Affairs and Communications and the Keidanren, the Japan Business Federation. And that is the opportunity, I think, for the IGF to be given some profile, and it may help with the problem raised by Izumi in terms of increasing awareness in Japan in particular of the importance of the IGF. My minister has a speaking slot in that, and I will try and get reference to the IGF in his speech at the multi-stakeholder conference in Japan. It's in Takamatsu on the 29th of April. Hope that's helpful. Thank you.
Thank you, Mark. Klaus, you have the floor.
Thank you very much, Madam Chairman, and as many before, congratulations to your recent appointment. I would like to follow up on some of the remarks here. It's about that, yeah, it sounds like a platitude, but it's true, everybody's affected by ICTs, but if everybody is affected by ICTs, everybody's equally affected by internet governance. And if we have a lot of programs about internet literacy, we should really have as part of the IGF a conscious outreach program on internet governance literacy. And this should really, as started so brilliantly in Brazil with students and young people, this should approach businesses, this should approach governments, this should approach basically every internet users. And for example, why does it have to be the IGF all the time as himself? Why can't we ask students to reach out to students? Why can't we reach out business to reach out to business? Why can't we ask governments to reach out to governance? So my plea and my proposal is quite simply, let's think seriously about internet governance outreach. And just because I always do things the wrong way around, it's civil society, Global Knowledge Partnership Foundation, and also NPOC and ICANN. And as a last remark on this one, I think this program is, or the initiative like that would be also important, just simply to support the multi-stakeholder process. The grassroots engagement, bottom-up engagement needs participation, otherwise it's dead. Otherwise, we use just platitudes. Thank you.
Thank you, Klaus. Online participation, Anya?
Thank you, Madam Chair. I'm going to read three comments and then Jack would like to intervene. From Deirdre Williams, we spend lots of energy on internet as a place. Perhaps we need to balance this with internet as a tool because we need policy for use of the tool as well as policy for behavior in the place. Second comment, Michael Ohia, Istanbul, past ISOC ambassador to IGF 10. I submitted input collected from my fellow ISOC ambassadors to the secretariat on their behalf, and many of them echoed my concerns, as well as many other individuals' concerns, about the amount of time dedicated to open forum discussions. The amount of time allocated in João Pessoa was clearly not enough, and I encouraged the MEC to expand the crucial space for expression and discussion at IGF 11. From Peter Dengentrush, I agree with Elizabeth that input from the wider community, for example, here today, is important and useful as the MAG discusses MAG chair appointment processes. It's not clear to me where on the MAG agenda this item is to be discussed. And now Jack would like to make an intervention. Jack, I'm going to unmute you now.
Hello, can you hear me? Just checking.
Yes, we can.
Thank you very much. I'd just like to raise, I guess, three comments. One is to support the interventions earlier around discussing process and transparency around, I guess, not just around the MAC selection, the overall working processes of the IGF. I think it's a really good opportunity for us here, given the renewed 10-year mandate. So, for example, also thinking through how intersessional work links to IGF work in a sustained way and deepening the inter-institutional work that IGF faces within the UN and with other policy processes. So, for example, we could also be using some of the outputs of the IGF to inform other processes like the HRC. Secondly, I would like to really recommend the continued strengthening of the intersessional work. It's been a very useful process to continue the conversation beyond the IGF event in itself, and that it's produced quite solid work and outcome. And to really support human rights-related thematic issues to be a consistent topic for this, and also for the IGF, because the especially important given human rights really encompass such a diverse area, and it is very relevant to internet policy discussion. And the IGF is a unique space to foster multi-stakeholder conversations within this thematic area and to increase links with other UN processes as well. And then I would like to recommend the continued development and strengthening of the dynamic coalition work as one of the primary platforms for intersessional work for the IGF. Thought needs to be given to how the work of the DCs is shared and that it allows for broader engagement with the broader IGF community, and that the MAG and Secretariat should play a continued role to support this process. So, for example, two concrete areas of work from the Gender Dynamic Coalition, which I'm a part of, is to develop a sexual harassment policy for the IGF. I think this is particularly timely given some of the discussions that has come up from the ICANN meeting as well. And secondly, is the gender report card that the Gender Dynamic Coalition has been working on. Last year is the fourth year in which the report card has been done, but it remains somehow outside of the good monitoring and statistical work that the Secretariat does to ensure to keep track of diversity and participation. But maybe some steps and discussion needs to be taken on how to integrate this in terms of the work of the DC together with the other pieces of puzzle that makes sure that drives the work of the IGF. And finally, I think that it's quite. I think maybe we should discuss an opportunity for protesters to present their concern during the IGF, given the experience last year where peaceful and silent protesters were actually removed on the first day. And this is, of course, against freedom of expression, but also it's not the first time that this has happened. It's clearly the IGF is a space that is important for people to come and present their concerns, and I think we need to think about a space that allows for this to happen in a way that is respectful of human rights. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Jack, and all the other online participants. That was the end. And Ada, you have the floor.
Thank you very much. For the record, Aida Mahmutovic from Bosnia and Herzegovina, representing civil society, second-time MAG member, and also a member of organizing committee for the first Bosnian and Herzegovinian IGF, which took place on October 2015. We had 109 participants from all stakeholder groups with almost 50-50 gender balance among all speakers, moderators, organizing committee, and participants. And this was organized in only 3 months, so you can imagine what a hard work that was. And they were, we believe, two key facts for the successful event. First one was the outreach, which really meant a really simple explanations among different stakeholders within the country on what internet governance is and why is it important for them to join the process. The second one was really the key one, and it was the support from international organizations such as APC, ICANN, Council of Europe, OSCE representative of media, RIPE, NCC, Diplo Foundation, and of course IGF Secretariat and IGF SA that gave us huge support. So this was the key, because at that point was when the government representatives, private sector, and others really considered the importance of joining the process once they heard that we had this support from the international organizations. As for the including voices from national and regional levels, as far as I know, all enlisted initiatives need to submit IGF reports, which from few that I've read include really detailed information on challenges within those communities and regions. And I know that it takes a lot of time for people who work on those reports, so therefore I suggest that in the future we should take a look into these reports and see how and what we can collect from that. On the other note, I would just like to inform you that tomorrow I was kindly asked from LAC Youth to present to you a letter of claim to MAG. So this will be for tomorrow, just to let you know. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ada. Michael, you were out of the room when we called you earlier, so you now have the floor.
Thank you very much, Lynn. I apologize for having to step out briefly. I wanted to respond to something that was said and has been said a couple different times in a couple different ways, and that is that we need to involve people from different disciplines, different sectors. And I fully agree with those people who say we need to involve people from finance and healthcare and education in discussions about internet governance. I have a problem when we start going so broad that we're going to talk about those sectors and internet, because we can suddenly find ourselves really having no boundaries and ending up with a conference that will try to offer everything to everyone and in the end offer nothing to nobody. Because in these sectors like finance, they're having their own conferences and they're bringing internet experts in to show them how to use the internet to do banking better. The thing they're not doing is having conversations about the critical internet governance decisions that are going to affect the finance sector. Same thing for healthcare, same thing for e-government, same thing for education. And so I hope that as we reach out to these groups, we're not advertising ourselves as the place to come and hear case studies about how the internet is going to help them. And instead, we're reaching out to them and saying, we need your help in making decisions about how the internet itself will evolve so that we can do it in a way that supports them. And those are two very different questions. And the one that pertains to internet governance is well-defined, much narrower, and I think would allow us to be really have an impact on those decisions. So just a warning and a call for a plea for focus and boundaries.
Thank you, Michael. Ambassador Fonseca, you have the floor.
Thank you, Madam Chair, but I think ICANN's flag was raised before mine, if you wish to give them the floor. Thank you. I can speak now, but I'd like to make a comment on what you're going to say, so I reserve it. But then maybe I can just start by saying that in regard to, I've been hearing a few comments in regard to how to make sure we have more government participation. And I think from our experience working since Net Mundial and organizing IGF last year, we think it's very important to have some initiatives, government to government outreach, besides anything we can do as IGF, as MAG, in a multi-stakeholder format towards government. We have both, in preparation for Net Mundial and for IGF, organized briefings in Brasilia directed to the foreign missions. We think it's important at this level to flag this to governments. At least you'll get each embassy preparing a report to their capitals, and this will be digested nationally. And also there is also some interest in making some events government to government in places like New York or here in Geneva. I leave this as suggestions to the Mexican coordination and host country for this year, because we were convinced that that kind of government-to-government outreach had a significant impact in regard to attracting government participation. We think it's very important to show to other governments the perception we have of the benefits in working in the multi-stakeholder format in discussing internet governance-related aspects. It is very important for them to hear from government representatives their assessment and their positive views in that regard. And I'm saying this, of course, this does not in any way seek to limit or impair any multi-stakeholder approach, but the government-to-government perspective outreach is very important. Thank you.
Thank you, Ambassador Fonseca. We actually had closed the queue for this session about eight speakers back when I went through the list. We actually have a number of interventions that were actually scheduled for this last hour having to do with some sort of partnership and other internet governance organizations. I'd like to pull those in. If the three or four people that have their flags up now are certain they can, one, be brief, and two, it's to this current set of discussions, then I think we can do that. But I do want to be respectful of the people that the Secretariat had previously queued up for this time to make their interventions. So, and Nigel, I'm not certain if you were on, because you're on the other list as well. So you're on the other list, okay. So with that, I'll give the floor to Liesl, and then we will move to the agenda, item 4.
Thank you, Chair, and thank you for your indulgence, and I promise to be brief. First of all, my name is Liesl Franz from the U.S. Department of State, and I'm happy to be joining not my first open consultation or MAG meeting, but my first as a new MAG member. So thank you for that, and congratulations to you, Lynn, for your chairmanship. The only thing, just listening to the conversation today, just spurred me to make a comment about perhaps building on Mike Nelson's comment about focus and boundaries, keeping in mind that we do now have a 10-year mandate. So that gives us the opportunity of having an arc or a continuum of conversations. And while we may not all be on the MAG, say, for the next 10 years, we might be involved in the community. So we can think about, as we think about the planning for IGF or the improvements or the projects that we might be thinking about engaging in order to build participation from developing countries or capacity building or outreach opportunities to national and regional IGFs, we have the opportunity now to think about that in a arc or continuum. And I just wanted to put that out there for us to keep in mind. So we don't have to boil the ocean in the next 3 days or even the next 3 months, but maybe we can give ourselves a longer project plan. Thank you.
Thank you, Liesl. I wanted to just address one comment from this last session. Both Elizabeth and Peter had asked where on the agenda tomorrow was the additional discussion. That was under the first agenda item, specifically, I think, C and D, which had a MAG orientation, discussion role and responsibilities, and discussion on IGF MAG modalities. I think one of the things we're going to have to be quite careful of, though, tomorrow is managing our time. That is a very full day. And I think with perhaps that subject and other subjects, we may actually move into working groups or some other discussions or maybe some of our virtual MAG calls or something. But in fact, that was where the discussion was intended to come if it arose up in the open consultations here. So I will also take the point to go away with the secretariat, and we'll do a scan of the agenda over the next 2 days and see if we think any other adjustments are needed, and if so, be in touch with the MAG on that. So with that, this last agenda item actually pulls from the IGF, the Tunis agenda, which makes it clear that these processes are supposed to facilitate discourse across internet governance activities, organizations, and institutions. So in that vein, there were a number of projects that either I think the Secretariat thought or other organizations thought would be worthwhile to bring to the attention of this room. I have a few specific requests, and maybe I can start with the one that's remote and then look to the other people that are in the room here to put their flag up. So one in specific, there was a request from the World Economic Forum. They unfortunately couldn't be here today. They're on a plane on their way to New York, but they did provide a short statement to the Secretariat that somebody in the Secretariat is going to read out. Thank you. Brian?
Yes, thanks, Lynn. I'll read this verbatim from World Economic Forum submitted by Alex Wong, who is coordinating, managing the Future of the Internet Initiative. Here's the statement. The World Economic Forum Future of the Internet Initiative has an objective to ensure that the Internet benefits all humankind through better public-private collaboration. Given that one of the initiative's focus areas is around access adoption through the Internet for All project, and also given that the Future of the Internet Initiative has already contributed to IGF's efforts in 2015 on the Connecting the Next Billion paper, the World Economic Forum would like to deepen its engagement with the MAG in this area. This could specifically be in the form of the forum's commitment to continue to support and provide input into any Connecting the Next Billion activities that may be planned for the coming year, inviting the MAG to participate in the Future of the Internet Initiative, and all of their activities, which will take place at the national, regional, and global levels throughout 2016, and specifically anticipated regions of focus will be the Africa Northern Corridor, Latin America, and India. And the engagement of national and regional IGFs in particular would be welcome. There's also an offer to possibly co-host an Internet for All connectivity type session during the IGF, day zero, or whenever appropriate. And that was all.
Thank you, Brian. I think we can make this statement available to the MAG members as well and post it on the MAG list. Christina, did you want to come back in on JIPO?
Thank you, Madam Chair. Yes, thank you for the opportunity to say a few words on JIPO, the Global Internet Policy Observatory, and to also introduce this project to the new MAG members. The Global Internet Policy Observatory is a project which has been kick-started by the European Commission last year, and it aims at responding, or at least contributing to responding to the needs that have been highlighted by many of you during this session. That is, the need of having access to an adequate level of information regarding internet governance and internet-related policies around the world. The aim of this tool is precisely to provide this information in an automatic way. So the tool looks at the most relevant information through a selected sources, which can be seen by all users. It assigns scores to this content, and then it enriches this content with metadata. All this is done automatically so that this information can be used in a variety of ways. So we could say that JIPO is a provider of pre-digested information on internet governance and policy, which can then be further curated, for instance, by other observatory tools which focus more on this kind of activities, but also directly to the stakeholder that needs to get access to this kind of information. Another possible use that has emerged while discussing with several stakeholders has been also how the tool could be used to facilitate processes like the IGF or regional and national IGFs, in the sense that the tool could classify content and provide a management tool to access this content. For the time being, there is a prototype available. It's just a beta version, which is accessible for everybody. The team that is working on the development of the tool arranges regular webinars and physical events with interested stakeholders to develop the tool in a way that could be really useful to the final user. As I mentioned at the beginning, this project is kick-started by the European Commission, so we put some money in it, but it is really thought as a tool for the global community. So we do not wish to necessarily be the sole owners of this tool. I would invite MAG members to visit the website jiponet.org, and from there you can access the tool, which is still in beta version. Additional functionalities will be developed throughout the year. This means that there is still scope to adapt the tool to specific needs. And therefore, I would like to invite MAG members, but also the IGF Secretariat, to consider how this tool could facilitate your tasks, but also how it could facilitate cooperation and exchanges with other mapping initiatives and other observatories. I have to say that something remarkable that has happened is that in the last couple of years, there has been a sort of explosion of initiatives, and we are in touch with more than 30 initiatives at different levels, regional, national, or international, all trying to provide answers and solutions to the complexity of internet governance. And by the simple fact of being in touch, all these initiatives can exchange best practices and can really together advance and provide something useful. So this is also an interesting aspect and a new development, I would say. So just for your information, on the 20th of April, there will be a webinar on how JIPO will approach multilingualism. The idea is that the tool will be multilingual, at least provide functionalities in the five official languages of the United Nations. So something interesting. And finally, also there is an advisory group that has been set up to provide independent advice for the different aspects of the development of the project. And this advisory group works really independently from the European Commission. And there are a few MAG members who are part of the advisory group. So I think that it would be really great if they could act as a sort of liaison and also facilitate exchanges and help us assess how the tool could be useful for MAG. Then if you allow me just one point of information I just wanted to share as we are talking about internet governance related initiative, just for your information, the European Commission is planning this year to focus some of its activities on jurisdiction on the internet. And we are planning two workshops to take place in Brussels, one on a jurisdiction in the cloud and one on internet intermediaries. So this is just a point of information I wish to share. Thank you.
Thank you, Christina. Peter, you have the floor.
Thank you, Lynn. In my previous intervention, I tried to outline some aspects of the work the Commission on Science and Technology for Development, which is a UN commission, has been doing. So I think probably I have to be a bit more detailed about the work. So the Commission itself is a part of the Economic and Social Council of the United Nations. It's one of the specialized committees, commissions. It has two mandates. One mandate is related to the science issues. The other mandate is related to the World Summit on Information Society. I don't really want to deal with the first mandate, which is of relevance here, is the task of the Commission related to the WISIS. The Commission each year provides a report to the, of the UN Secretary General on the system-wide review. It also drafts a resolution for the ECOSOC on the WISIS-related issues, and this is the basis for the United Nations General Assembly's resolution. And last but not least, the Commission has created two working groups. One working group, which has been already mentioned, was the working group on the improvements to the IGF, which has successfully completed its work. The other working group was the working group of enhanced cooperation. I don't really want to go into detail about what is enhanced cooperation and what is not enhanced cooperation. I leave the pleasure to you. However, you may know that this working group I have been requested to continue the work of the working group, that is to establish a new one, and I would like to thank all of you who have participated, especially the focal points for the stakeholders who have participated in helping me to establish this working group, which was, I think, quite an open process, I hope, and the results of which will be posted, I think, by the end of this week on the website of the Commission on Science and Technology for Development. So as I have mentioned earlier, the outcome document of the VISIS Plus 10 encouraged the CSTD to continue the VISIS system-wide review. It also asked us to report on the implementation of the outcomes of the recommendations of the Working Group on Improvements, and identified and promote specific detailed actions to support enabling environment for RCTs and development. So basically, this is the linkage to my mind, to the SDGs. And I think, coming back to the first mandate, we have also tasks related to other high-level events, including the establishment of a UN-wide science forum, which will give us extra tasks. So basically, that is in a nutshell, and I think there are a lot of linkages between IGF and CSCD, and I sincerely hope that we are going to continue in a very positive way. Thank you.
Thank you, Peter. Arnoud, you have the floor.
Thank you, Madam Chair. First of all, my congratulations to your appointment as new chair. My name is Arnold van Rijn. I'm from the Netherlands government. And I'm happy to join the MAG as a new member. Previously, I participated in this meeting as an observer, active observer. And I also would like to congratulate all the other new MAG members and also say thanks to the outgoing members for their hard work. Let me share some information for you on a process which is related to the internet governance work, and that has to do with the Global Forum on Cyber Expertise. This Global Forum on Cyber Expertise has been launched during the Global Cyberspace Conference in The Hague in April last year. And this is a global platform for governments, international organizations, and private companies to exchange best practices and expertise on cyber capacity building. The aim is to identify successful policies, practices, and ideas, and multiply these on a global level, together with partners from NGOs, the technical community, and academia. GFC members develop practical initiatives to build capacity, cyber capacity. We had lately a call for nominations to an advisory board, and this is specifically dedicated for the NGOs, technical community, and academia. About 22 members should be elected by now, and hopefully they can build on the knowledge and expertise which we are looking for. Today, there are 11 initiatives which are being selected. And these initiatives are now going to be implemented, and a lot of information can be found on the website of the GFC, but I name a few of them. First is an initiative which deals with progressing cybersecurity in Senegal and West Africa. Another initiative is dealing with CSIRT maturity. And a third one is dealing with vulnerability disclosure initiatives, that is ethical hacking. So there are a lot of issues, cyber issues, which are being tackled in different regions of the world. And the process of implementing these 11 initiatives is going on. And if you want to have more information about these initiatives, I please advise you to visit the website of the GFCE. Thank you.
Thank you, Arnold. There were two more individuals who were invited to speak here. One is Nigel, I think, on the IANA transition. So, Nigel, you have the floor.
Yes, thank you very much, Madam Chair. I'll try and be brief. so the The INA transition is just a small initiative. No, sorry, I'll try and be serious. So I just thought it would be worth just giving a very brief update on where the INA stewardship transition is. As many of you know, it's been an initiative that, although ICANN have been facilitating, really it's been an initiative of the global internet community. It's certainly something that ICANN could not have taken forward without the active cooperation of a wide range of participants from a wide range of countries and from a wide range of backgrounds. And included in that is many people that are active in the IGF, many people that have been active in the MAG. It's been a true example of a multi-stakeholder process, and that might seem somewhat trite to say. But I think what it's done, and of course what Net Mondial did in such splendid fashion 2 years ago, just after the IANA transition was initiated, what Net Mondial did was to show how you can debate and agree on serious issues through a multi-stakeholder process. The complaint has often been that you can get people in a room and generate a lot of heat but not much light and not make many decisions. Well, Net Mondial showed that that was wrong, and the INA stewardship transition has agreed to fundamental and very detailed documents spelling out new processes at ICANN and beyond, which really are detailed and which really make some fundamental decisions. The INA transition itself is a replacement for the role that the US NTIA have in certain technical aspects of the internet, the root of the internet, for example, in approving new top-level domains into the root of the internet. And the transition arrangements, which were finally agreed at the end of the last ICANN meeting in Marrakesh on the 10th of March, envisage a process where the NTIA role is if you like replaced by a fairly complex mechanism of IANA staff with the global community in various groups and in various advisory committees. Linked to that is an accountability process, which is equally important, and this accountability process takes with it the premise that ICANN, as a board and a staff, of course, has to be accountable to the global community it serves. And this accountability process puts in various checks and balances and allows the internet community, under certain conditions, to take fairly important actions, including removal of the ICANN board. These processes are important to ICANN. We believe they're important to internet governance. We believe they're important to the global appreciation of the internet as we move forward, and puts all governments on an equal footing. But, Madam Chair, equally important, as I mentioned at the beginning, it shows how the global internet community can come together and make decisions. And that, I think, is relevant, and that, I think, is important in other areas in the global internet ecosystem. As such, we'll be discussing the results of this IANA transition at the WSIS forum. I think my colleague from ITU has gone, but it's a shame because I will still pay him a compliment. The WSIS forum, hosted by the ITU, we see as a very important occasion to outline key internet governance developments, and certainly we'll be doing such there with the help of the cross-community working group on internet governance. So I think I'll stop there. Just before that, though, just to mention that in terms of the process, the papers are now with the US government, the NTIA. They will be doing a consideration within Washington, and also a consideration of Congress as well. And we're hopefully that there will be a response before the summer, and that will then lead to a full implementation of the new measures by the end of September, when the current contract between the NTIA and ICANN expires. Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you, Nigel. And just for the record, the ITU was also asked for a submission, and I think that was their earlier contribution on the WSIS forum. I see Benedicto's flag is up for Brazil. And you're possibly responding to something in what Nigel said. I'd also like to give my other friends in Brazil the opportunity to perhaps give the room an update on the Net Mundial initiative, since that was a significant feature here in a lot of our discussions last year, and I think there's probably a short update that would be helpful. But first, Benedicto.
Thank you, Madam Chair, and thank you for Nigel for this briefing. I'd like just to say, in regard to what has been said by Nigel, that Brazil, as you know, is a country that has been fully engaged in multi-stakeholder initiatives, and we fully embrace this concept. Therefore, we have engaged very actively in the IANA transition process, in the process leading to the preparation of the transition proposal. We have participated both in the ICG and also in CCWG accountability working group. Therefore, from the perspective of governments, and however, from the perspective of governments, I have to express that we have a lot of concern with some provisions that made their way to the final proposal, which in our view imposes very severe restrictions on the government's capacity to participate. It is not accurate to say governments have equal participation. I think there is a recognition that the issues addressed by ICANN, names and numbers, critical resources, even when we look into the WISIS outcome documents, there is a very clear message that those areas should not be led by governments, and this is fully accepted, not only by Brazil, but by others. And governments have been retaining an advisory role in the present regime, and they will maintain that advisory role in the post-transition phase. So it is accepted by all of us, the governments, to remain, let's say, in that advisory capacity. However, there are a number of provisions that were included, and some of them at a very late stage in the negotiations that, as I said, and I'll not elaborate on this, I think, for those who are familiar, that deals with the consensus requirement for GAC advice to trigger consultation mechanisms with the Secretariat, and also what is called the carve-out mechanism. I'll not elaborate on this. For those who are interested, perception on this have been recorded in what we call the minority opinion that was attached to the proposal. And that minority opinion was supported not only by Brazil, but by countries like France, Portugal, Argentina, and others. And as you look into the list of countries who have that minority opinion, you clearly see that all those countries, or the immense, huge majority of those countries, are very enthusiastic supporters of the multi-stakeholder model and of ICANN in the way it works. But however, there was that very clear record of the position vis-a-vis some proposals that made it to the final piece that is now being considered by the U.S. government and Congress. So this is just for the record to say that we are supportive of the process. However, we are concerned with those provisions. We think that the way the process unfolded has nothing to do with Net Mundial. I'm sorry. I think Net Mundial had its agenda and its process elaborated in a truly bottom-up approach that was not in the final stages interfered with by other participants. I think the whole process was truly bottom-up and inclusive, and unfortunately we have not seen that kind of approach in the process. And I think what is most concern of us, because we have been participating in ICANN, but also here, also in New York, in the WISIS Plus 10, and in each and every context, we have consistently expressed our views that we support the multi-stakeholder approach. We support the full package that comes from the WISIS outcome documents, the multi-stakeholder approach, the notion that different stakeholders have different roles and responsibilities, and this is the way we try to balance. We had a very hard time in the WISIS Plus 10. I think it was a very balanced outcome, but one that took us a lot of effort, not only on the part of my delegation, of course, but working together with other delegations to bring on board some delegations that had very serious concerns about the multi-stakeholder approach. So it, I think, as I said before, it was important that Mexico had already offered to host IGF 2016. It was very important to have in the room during WISIS plus 10 negotiation delegations that were very firmly committed to this notion, because that had, let's say, a counterbalance effect in regard to other delegations that were not so much enthusiastic about this. So this leads me to the conclusion that the way the ICANN process unfolded makes us very concerned about those countries that were already reluctant to accept the multi-stakeholder format. If they see this, as the ICANN representative has said, as a truly multi-stakeholder way of doing things, I think we are in a very bad shape to convince those countries to embrace the multi-stakeholder approach. If they see that the multi-stakeholder approach is what took place in the ICANN process, I don't think that would be to the service of the multi-stakeholder effort as a whole. So we recognize what took place in ICANN as a very particular situation in a very in an organization that has a very clear, focused mandate that has already, even in the WISIS outcomes document, recognition that it should work in very particular ways. So this is all respected. However, we think there were some unnecessary restrictions that were imposed on governments as a whole, to the point that countries like Brazil, France, Portugal, Argentina, and others had to reject the final proposal. So I don't think that was, we hope and we expect the proposal to be fully implemented. And I think the overall objective to move from the unilateral jurisdiction of the US is something we can also support. But I think those, let's say, elements that were added do not help us in these, in the way years ahead, in regarding to bring on board everyone, and including governments, around multi-stakeholder processes. Thank you.
No, thank you, Benedicto. And I think we, again, certainly owe thanks to both Mexico and Brazil for all of their efforts to support the WISIS plus 10 process and the renewal. And certainly your efforts in New York in the latter part of last year were critical to that effort. At the same time, I think your comments also pull out the notion that critical internet resources have been a piece of the internet governance debate, and specifically IGF, since the very earliest days of WISIS I, in fact. And it seems as though they will be with us for some time yet, which is maybe not a surprise. But thank you for your very measured comments. I would like to come to, I'm not sure if it's Hartmut or Flavio, though Hartmut, for a quick update on the Net Mundial initiative. Thank you.
It's very clear for most of us that Net Mundial was a one-time event. And Net Mundial initiative was born later, was a joint agreement between WEF, ICANN, and CGI, and now that ICANN and WEF don't will stay in this effort together with CGI, that CGI needs to discuss and reset all the initiative. We are exactly on this moment discussing in Brazil internally as CGI how we will follow this platform. Very, very, very clear. Net Mundial initiative is not an event. Net Mundial initiative is a platform that the idea is to offer to the world for best practices, for some good examples that we have worldwide. But CGI needs to discuss, because if we now are alone on this project, on this effort, it's not a negative way to say alone. We need to reconsider the all the details, the coordination, the next steps. Until the end of June, the council, the coordination council, will be in place, and we are just in the middle of the process to redesign and to discuss internally how this will be put in place after June 2016. So please wait until we have our final proposal. Thank you.
No, thank you. That was the list of speakers that we had from the Secretariat of people who had sort of requested some time to point out as a significant or specific partnership or relationship with the IGF. And given the fact we're fast approaching 6 o'clock, I think I'd like to stop the conversation there. Sorry, I was being waved to from the back. If this is about announcing the reception out front, I'll come to that in just a moment. I'm there already, I'll stay there for a moment. There's a reception immediately out in front here that I believe is hosted by the Internet Society, and everybody's welcome. And I think at the moment, I'm not sure if Chengatai has any other administrative items, or if there are any other closing remarks or comments from the others. You're all set as well. Chengatai is looking thoughtful, so I'm going to give him a no. They said we will take a moment and revisit the agenda here in the light of the discussions we've actually had, and if there's any you know, significant changes or draft agendas, we'll get something out to the MAG, and then of course we start the meeting tomorrow with a discussion on the agenda and approval. Cheryl's asked for a short comment.
I just really quickly, thank you, Madam Chair, really quickly wanted to say thank you. I know that there are a few non-MAG members, observers in the room, and for some of them it's their first time, and we really appreciate their participation. I know the first meeting can sometimes be overwhelming, but just really appreciate that the fact that they took the time and are here with us today.
No, that's it's a very important comment. I mean, an open community discussion or day is nothing if there's no community. So certainly appreciate everybody who did spend time here. Hope that you'll come back and spend the next 2 days as well. I think I'd also like to recognize and support all the individuals that have participated online. These may seem like long days here in the room. They're even longer when you're participating online, either by yourself or in the background of other meetings. But the contributions and participation is important. I think we also need to thank the interpreters for being here, and certainly for the scribes for the excellent work. I think there's been a really high quality of scribing, and that helps tremendously, I think, not only people in the room, but for the record post the meeting and for those participating online. And I think I'd like to just thank the Secretariat for their great work supporting us here. And otherwise, we're adjourned, and we'll be back here tomorrow morning at 10. Thank you.